composer a great success during the first decades of the 20th century. However, Schrecker's reputation diminished in the years leading to Hitler's ascent to power in 1933, when he was removed from musical society. And in 1938, his compositions were labeled Entartete Musik, or degenerate music, by the Nazis, in a public display in Dusseldorf, Germany. The Third Reich and post-war Germany saw Schrecker as a decadent outcast, misunderstanding his unique style that combined elements of late Romanticism, Expressionism, Impressionism, and Symbolism in his instrumental, operatic, and especially his lesser-known Lieder compositions. The Nazis labeled these qualities un-German and anti-nationalist at the end of Schrecker's life, and some critics often disagreed with his concept of musical modernism. In post-war culture, he was cast out as a feature of the distant past and has been largely forgotten to a modern generation of musicians. Schrecker was born to a Bohemian Jewish father who converted to Christianity and a Catholic mother. His father was a well-known photographer when it was still a new art form in Hungary, Austria, and many other areas of Europe from 1860 until 1888, when he died on a photography job. After his father's death, Schrecker's musical gift was discovered and nurtured with lessons in piano, organ, violin, theory, and harmony in the northern Viennese district of Döbling. At the young age of 14, Schrecker moved out on his own to help his family financially by playing violin and tutoring many different subjects, including math, reading, and writing. A self-assured young man, as described by one of his music teachers during his youth, Schrecker began composing around the time he began his music lessons. His early compositions and musical talent showed promise and confidence to those that knew him, eventually leading him to study at the Vienna Conservatory. Schrecker's time at the conservatory would foster his gift for composition and lead to the majority of his Lieder output. However, the combination of stylistic features that Schrecker employed in his undiscovered 49 songs show an innovation for the genre of the German Lied, an innovation that combined modern elements of French melodie, the Viennese avant-garde, and German expressionism. Although this was a time of innovations, the conservative critics in Vienna often criticized Schrecker's music. His Lieder progressed stylistically in three stages. First, the songs from his educational years at the Vienna Conservatory in 1898 until 1900 that resemble a late Romantic style. The second period is an innovative combination of styles in the first decade of the 20th century, avant-garde in Vienna. And the final period ends with an expressionistic and lyrical style during the height of his fame in Berlin. A clear progression from a late Romantic modernism to an innovative, expressionistic, and lyrical style in the early 20th century will support that these songs deserve mention in the repertoire and history of the German Lied. In a 1921 article in the Musikblätter des Anbruch, or Music Leaves from a New Dawn, a music journal started to promote modern music in Vienna, Schrecker defended his unique compositional style, stating, quote, "I am impressionist, expressionist, internationalist, futurist, musical verist. Been a Jew and come up through the power of Judaism, Christ, and made a Catholic under the patronage of an ultra-Catholic Viennese princess. I am a sound artist. I am a melodist of the purest blood. Perverse, nevertheless, a full-blooded musician. But I'm also an idealist, thank God. Symbolist, stand at the leftmost wing of modernism with Schoenberg and Debussy. Am an absolutely strange human being, but what, for heaven's sake, I'm not? I'm not, yet, over the edge, not a megalomaniac, not bitter, I'm not an ascetic, not a bungler or a dilettante, and I've never written a review." End quote. Schrecker wrote most of his early songs while studying with Robert Fuchs at the Vienna Conservatory, many of which remained unpublished until 2005. According to the author Edward Kravitt, during this time at the end of the 19th century, composers of the German elite, quote, were encouraged to breathe intensity of feeling into their music, such as was found in the works of Liszt and Wagner, concentrating on declamation, vivid characterization, and the use of leitmotifs, end quote. Composers and contemporaries of Schrecker, such as Hugo Wolf, Gustav Mahler, and Richard Strauss, were publishing their contributions to the genre, while Schrecker studied intensively with Fuchs at the conservatory. Schrecker's early songs were often criticized for being too much like Brahms, with no individuality in form and artistry. However, Schrecker's vocal style meant to evoke emotions rather than explain them. The Mutterlieder, or Mother Songs, show the beginning of his unique musical style that combined many different elements of the time. The Mutterlieder is a set of six songs originally intended to be published together as a cycle. All six are based on Mia Holm's poems on the death of children. The first five are from her Mutterlieder collection, and one other additional poem not in that collection. Two of the six songs from the intended cycle were published in 1904 as Opus 5, two songs on the death of children. However, the remaining four were left unpublished until 2005 in a collection of Schrecker's Lieder for Universal Editions in Vienna. Mia Holm is not a common name in the Lieder repertoire. Other than Schrecker, only Eduard Lassen said one of her poems titled März. A 19th century female poet born in 1845 in Latvia, Holm died in Munich in 1912. The Mutterlieder collection was published in 1897 in Paris. All are from a woman's point of view and recall a mother's perspective in losing a child, and are traditional in the scope of Lieder. The first song of the Mutterlieder, O Glocken, böse Glocken, is a somber depiction of funeral bells after the death of a child. Schrecker uses a motive in the left hand of the piano in open intervals to begin his depiction of the funeral.
Oh,
cycle is a short description of the intense, icy pain of death to those that are left behind. Fueled by agitated, repeated chords in both hands of the piano, traditional harmony in D minor, and a full use of the tessitura in the vocal line, this piece shows the stage of wild, chaotic grief that accompanies death and loss.
Thank you.
Die Fenster Zitternsacht, Schlecker includes some of the same techniques from the previous songs, such as the interplay of changing meters, alternating key centers, and the oscillation of open intervals. However, in this song, he uses a 2-against-3 rhythm to create a ghostly atmosphere where the dead child's voice speaks to the mother from an ethereal distance.
Do it.
Conservatory in 1900, and when he composed his next set of Lieder, the Fünfgesänge, in 1909, Vienna's musical culture was introduced to many modern composers, including Schrecker, Schoenberg, Berg, and Zimnitsky. The photo seen above is a photo of Schrecker, Schoenberg, and Zimnitsky with one of the many new musical organizations that was formed for the encouragement of modern music in Vienna, which Schrecker was the musical director of. In Vienna's artistic community, the flowing images of Art Nouveau were developing into the Jugendstil movement, and such paintings as Gustav Klimt's The Kiss of 1909 were leading to the Viennese avant-garde. It is also at this time that Schrecker's first opera, Flammen, was premiered in 1902, as well as the beginning compositional stages of one of his most famous operas, Der Fanecon. His early Lieder were becoming popular in Viennese concert halls starting in 1905. On March 10, 1908, 20 of Schrecker's songs were performed by tenor Adolf Lussmann. Elmer Budde commented on Schrecker's vocal works at the 1978 Schrecker Symposium in West Berlin, stating, quote, "The focus of his overall work, as if it was his musical and spiritual center, is opera. In second place are the songs," end quote. The Fünfgesänge, or Five Songs, combine elements of symbolism, impressionism, and expressionism, which made Schrecker a leading composer in Viennese modernism in the early 20th century. Schrecker composed these pieces in 1909 after meeting Arnold Schoenberg, his close friend for many years, and admitted that these five songs were among his favorite compositions. He decided to orchestrate them in April of 1923, and the world premiere took place in Vienna in 1924 with the Vienna Symphony Orchestra. Since its premiere, the orchestral version has been performed only five times. Schrecker chose to use four poems by Edith Ronsberger, born in 1880 and died in 1921 of a rumored suicide in Florence. Eric Korngold also set one of Ronsberger's poems in his 1920 Abschiedslieder. The heaviness of these poems that Schrecker selected are only intensified by the richness of innovative musical techniques, such as expanded tonality, a declamatory vocal style, and detailed expressive markings in the score for both the piano and voice. The first song, Ich frag nach dir jedwede Morgensonne, is a poem from A Thousand and One Nights, which was translated into German by Ernst Schellenberg. Schrecker sets the vocal line in a declamatory, recitative-like fashion in the lower ranges of the voice at the beginning of the song, seen in example 3. The technique of text declamation was becoming a popular technique in vocal music during this time and can be seen in the vocal music of Debussy, which influenced German-speaking countries in the first decades of the 20th century. For Schrecker, text gave him the musical form he needed to create a vocal composition. Ich frag nach dir. Rost, wo sind nächte Quelle dir? Dunkelheit singt schwer wie Blei, the third song of the Fünf Gesänge cycle. Ronsberger's description of the darkness is eerily encrypted with naturalistic tendencies that reflect the French symbolist movement. In example four, Schrecker uses the darkness of the poem in his setting by using an oscillating minor third motif that signals the tolling of the bell of death and dying. In Sie sind so schön, die milden Sonnenreichen, Schrecker lets the meter of the text form the music that he sets. By not using bar lines or a time signature in this song, Schrecker allows the language of Ronsberger's poem to stand out. This poem embodies nostalgic memories of autumn and love. Schrecker illuminates the absence of bar lines with an eighth note steadiness to both the accompaniment and the syllabic vocal line.
Sieger, Weg und Warten.
composition. He did not follow Schoenberg and his disciples, but he did not stay left behind. As Christopher Haley of the Schrecker Foundation wrote of this era, quote, "The true miracle of Viennese musical modernism lies in the fact that within a single decade, roughly the 10 years between Schrecker's Mutterlieder and his five songs, one city produced such an astonishing array of compelling individual compositional voices," end quote. Schrecker was one of those unique voices to come out of the early 20th century of German song composition. During the years between the piano version of the Fünfgesänge and the next period in Schrecker's evolution as a song composer, the world experienced its first world war. As Schrecker was becoming internationally known throughout Europe, the war put a hold on most modern music, featuring mainly traditional and patriotic music in mainstream culture. Schrecker responded to the war by saying in 1914, quote, "This is a time against art and all creative things, but the world won't go under and the beautiful will survive the horrible," end quote. Indeed, Schrecker's career blossomed after the war, and until 1923, he saw world premieres of four of his operas. Although he was not called to fight in the war, he took the time to compose, and according to his biographer Christopher Haley, it was the most productive compositional time in his life. In 1923, he composed Vom ewigen Leben, zwei lyrische Gesänge aus den Grashalmen von Walt Whitman, a cycle of two songs based on the poetry of Walt Whitman for soprano and piano, as well as an orchestrated version of the songs in 1927. These two Whitman songs have been placed alongside Strauss's orchestral songs, Brahms's Vier Ernste Gesänge, and the symphonic leader of Max Reger. Schrecker's Whitman songs are ambiguous when it comes to genre. One reviewer wrote, after seeing the world premiere of the orchestral version, that, quote, "This is a new kind of orchestral song, which could best be described as a solo cantata," end quote. Schrecker Foundation President Haley explains that what makes these songs so powerful is, quote, "Schrecker's mastery of the broad, text-sensitive lyric line, which culminates in his exquisite Whitman settings," end quote. Whitman's original American poems were translated by Hans Reisinger in 1922. It might seem strange for an American poet from the 19th century to turn up in an early 20th century German Lied, but Walt Whitman's introduction into German-speaking countries began in 1868, after a small collection of his poems were translated into German. Whitman's poetry surged throughout Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. Due to Central Europe's increasing appetite for Whitman's poetry, many composers began to take notice of his language and subject matters. For example, besides Schrecker, Ottmar Schuck, Paul Hindemith, Kurt Weill, and Ernst Toch all composed works based on Whitman's poems. Schrecker chose two poems from Whitman's Leaves of Grass that use the symbol of grass from which life stems as a main theme. Therefore, Schrecker gave this cycle the title Vom ewigen Leben, or Eternal Life. By looking at the first song of these two, it is easy to see the musical development that took place from Schrecker's 1909 Fünfgesänge. The first song, in the piano version of 1923, is based on Whitman's Roots and Leaves Themselves Alone, the 13th poem in the Calamus section of Leaves of Grass. Although both the vocal melody and the piano accompaniment are highly chromatic, both parts exude a lyrical quality that Schrecker's vocal music tends to portray. The music is highly contrapuntal in nature in the first 11 measures, which can be seen here in example 6. Strecker orchestrated these two Whitman songs in 1927. However, the world premiere did not occur until April 14, 1929, in Leipzig. Vom Ewigen Leben enjoyed success during the end of Strecker's life until the changing political atmosphere in Germany halted the performances of his music, including the Whitman songs. The rise of the National Socialist Party in Germany created a complicated and oppressive political atmosphere in Berlin. Since 1920, Strecker was named director of the Berlin Hochschule für Musik, as well as being a Senate and faculty member of the Prussian Academy for the Arts. In the increasingly hostile political climate in the early 30s, Strecker went about his duties as director of the Hochschule until he became a central figure in a growing controversy between two of the school's professors. One violin professor published a comment that Russian and Polish Jews produced a better tone on the violin, and considering that most of his students were of Jewish heritage, another violin professor and Nazi sympathizer was infuriated. This professor blamed Strecker for hiring the other violin professor, and in June of 1932, Strecker resigned as director of the Hochschule to escape the attacks that the scandal had created. At the time of Strecker's resignation at the Hochschule, his health began to fail from job stress and the intensity of his compositional work, suffering from nervousness, insomnia, high blood pressure, and asthma attacks. Although he had resigned from the Hochschule, he still had an official position teaching the composition masterclass at the Prussian Academy in 1932, alongside Schoenberg. In January of 1933, Adolf Hitler was named Chancellor of Germany, making political associations exceedingly important within the music industry, academic institutions, and performing ensembles. By December of 1933, Hitler's view of musical culture included only German aesthetics, looking down on any modern music. According to author Michael Haas, one of Hitler's faithful followers was composer Hans Pfitzner, who had the idea that, quote, international influences such as Impressionism that both Schoenberg and Strecker had used in their early works only confirmed, in his view, how un-German they were, end quote. The ideals of a nationalistic German music was implemented into the Musical Society of Berlin, and composers such as Strecker, Schoenberg, and many others were finding it harder to gain acceptance in a drastically different musical landscape. Nazi propaganda fueled the disintegration of modern music in Germany, and Hitler's campaign against non-Aryan musical culture exploded in the spring of 1933, when the removal of Jews from all academic posts began due to anti-Semitic policies in university hiring. In May of 1933, Strecker, who suspected that his father was Jewish, alongside Schoenberg, were both suspended from the academy. An official questionnaire followed from Max von Schillings, the Academy's president, in June regarding Strecker's family heritage. Strecker was forced to find proof from Hungary that his father was indeed Jewish by birth and was officially dismissed from the Academy in September 1933. The impression that increased steadily since just before the Third Reich came to power made Strecker into a nervous shell of a man, not to mention ending his musical career and financial stability. It is no wonder that in December of 1933, Strecker suffered the first of two strokes. He suffered paralysis on one side of his body, and soon after, suffered another stroke, which left him immobile. Franz Strecker passed away on March 21, 1934. He was buried 2 days later on his 56th birthday. According to Christopher Haley, his funeral was not well attended, and the brief publicity of his death often categorized him as, quote, a decadent offshoot of late romanticism. who had to end his life in isolation, end quote. This was a tragic end to a composer who inspired and influenced so many musicians of his own and future generations, many of whom immigrated to other parts of the world, including the United States. Paul Becker, Schreker's longtime friend and music critic, felt Schreker's passing very deeply. He wrote an article in March of 1934 discussing his death, stating, quote, "A hard life has found its conclusion. Franz Schreker is dead at 56 years old. One could say extinguished. There were two options for him, new beginnings or the end. The first was perhaps an unlikely path. With Schreker, it turned out differently. He has ceased. This man was one of the strangest phenomena of our time. Schreker's death will probably cause to repeat those old phrases that sounded almost automatically when his name was called. Schreker has been entangled in a strange, muffled tragedy. As far as the extrinsic sound that was in him, he is now extinguished. Schreker is among those who have to call once more for justice in the world," end quote. The tragedy of Schreker's demise is one of massive proportions, and Becker is right to call on the world to seek justice, to never forget the man and his music. The impression of Schreker's musical legacy only became worse in the coming years of the Third Reich. In a 1938 display entitled Entartete Musik, or Degenerate Music, the Nazis exhibited the abnormal, eccentric, and modern musicians and composers that posed a threat to German musical culture of the Third Reich. This music did not portray the necessary German qualities Hitler enforced and was banned from being performed, recorded, or published. Even 4 years after his death, Schreker's name and music was added to the list of degenerate composers, as we can see on this Nazi poster that reads, quote, "Two Jewish hacks," end quote, with a sketch of Schreker and composer Ernst Toch. The Third Reich had every intention of banishing his musical legacy from history, defaming his name, his music, and the very essence of who he was because of his association with musical modernism and his Jewish heritage. In the years following World War II, the name Franz Schreker was an exile of the past. In post-war Germany, a new generation of musicians wished to move forward, forgetting the horrors of World War II, the Holocaust, and the Third Reich, developing new music throughout the 50s. Germany and the rest of Europe wished to rebuild, not reclaim the past. Consequently, Schreker was among the many composers and musicians whose artistic contributions were consigned to oblivion. Although the rebirth of Schreker's legacy has been slow, it has grown. Through scholarly work that began in a crawl, Schreker's name has been reintroduced to 20th and 21st century scholars and musicians. Although not all of the scholarly work done encourages a rebirth of Schreker, such as Theodor Adorno's 1959 Austrian radio talk, the importance lies in the subject matter, his music, which is now being discussed again. In 1978, the centennial year of Schreker's birth, a symposium was held in West Berlin, where several scholarly papers were given on Schreker's works. Two of them introduced Schreker's Lieder, most importantly, the Funkgesänge and the two Whitman songs. Along with the scholarly revival in Schreker's music, the interest in concert performances of his works has steadily begun to repopulate the literature of major symphonies and opera houses in Germany and Austria. While performances of his works on stage and in the concert hall have occurred in Europe, there has only been one performance of Schreker's operas in the United States. In 2010, at the Summer Festival at Bard College in New York State, Schreker's Der Faneklang made its American stage premiere. Out of all of Schreker's compositions, compositions, his operas, and orchestral works are gaining a small amount of recognition. However, The Leader lies, all published, and in obscurity. A few recordings exist of The Leader on Bridge and Capriccio Records. However, a mainstream addition to the German literature has not yet occurred. It is now high time that his Leader gets recognition for its stylistic innovations, expression, and modernization that he brought to the German Lied in the 20th century. Schrecker fought to keep his music alive without really understanding why he was oppressed. For one whose heritage remained partially Jewish, the socio-political climate would never have allowed him to go on fighting, however hard he tried. To rectify the past, his music must live on in the concert halls of the future. I just wanted to read this last quote to you that Schrecker said in an address to the Hochschule in Berlin. He said, quote, "One cannot make music with hate in one's heart," end quote. Thank you everybody for coming. I really appreciate you all being here and taking the time to learn about Franz Schrecker. I want to quickly thank my committee members who are here, Dr. Snyder, Dr. Wilson, and Dr. Mondelli. They've been very patient and wonderful. I want to thank my husband, who's right down here in the center, for keeping me alive during this degree, which is sometimes a hard thing here during a demon. And I want to thank the amazing Gloria Kim, who has been with me for four recitals. So, thank you guys.